Resignations, leaks, secret recordings and leaders gone rogue. In the 5 years since John Key resigned as Prime Minister, the National Party caucus has lived a rich and colourful experience. Stuff senior journalist Andrea Vance has detailed the bloodletting, the conniving and eventual path to relative political stability in her new book, Blue Blood, the inside story of the National Party in crisis. Kia ora, good morning.
Good morning.
I want to start with John Key's resignation. That's where the book starts. Do you think, upon reflection, John Key did a good job of his succession planning?
Gosh, this is a $64 million question. It's really interesting because I kind of thought when I started to write the book, I kind of thought that he did. But then one really senior National Party figure said to me, listed all the names, you know, the Simon Bridges, Nikki Kay, you know, Judith Collins, and Todd Muller, and he said, well, they all blew it. So it was best laid plans and all that, but I think in politics, you can't underestimate events, and you can't underestimate the heights of people's ambitions and egos, and, you know, that's just politicians, that's just political parties, they're full of alpha people.
Yes. The book covers a particularly tumultuous period, and I want to talk about two destabilising figures in particular. First of all, Jamie Lee Ross. How significant was Jamie Lee Ross's role in those destabilising times?
I think significant for Simon Bridges' leadership, significant in the whole House of Cards falling down, maybe not as much as we would think. I think it was inevitable that it was going to happen that way. It was going that way.
Why is that? Why do you think it was inevitable?
Because the train wreck was already in motion by then, you know. So what happened, a key theme of the book is that, yes, there was all this great succession planning in place, but because the key English Joyce machinery was so tight, so hierarchical and so successful that there was underlying frustrations and resentments, and everyone when Key left, everyone saw their chance. They're like, this is my chance to be, because every politician essentially wants to be prime minister or leader at some point. And so that everyone was jockeying for there was a lot of power plays going on. And so yes, Jamie Lee Ross was, it brought down Simon's leadership, and it set a whole lot of events in train. But essentially, that could have been anything. I think that would have happened anyway.
That's interesting. What about the role of outgoing party president Peter Goodfellow? What responsibility does he bear for the instability?
Well, in that he was part of the top team, I suppose, as much, maybe not as much as some of the senior figures, but certainly he was part of the establishment of the culture. And there were warning signs. He was part, you know, I think he took over the leadership in 08, 09. And there were warning signs all the way through about the tensions, the ambitions, the figures like Jamie Lee Ross and Judith Collins, and none of that was acted on. A lot of power was concentrated centrally, both in the board and in his leadership or his presidency, and then in the top people at the top, which sort of led to everything falling apart. So yeah, I think he does. I mean, he kept the party going, he kept the money flowing in, which is massively important for the National Party. But then he was involved in very intensely in a lot of those candidate selections, which then led to Jamie Lee
Ross.
Didn't
go terribly well.
No, Andrew Falloon, Hamish Walker, all those things. So yeah, he does have a part to play. Certainly there's some responsibility there.
I know it's always impossible to prove a counterfactual, but what do you think would have been the likeliest course for National if we'd never had COVID-19?
Oh, that's a great question.
Because they were polling really well.
They were, yeah. Yeah, well, certainly, and this is one of the things, again, that led to what happened. When 2017 happened and Winston was king, queenmaker, the National Party were very resentful, you know, and it even says that in the National Party report into the 2020 defeat. Mm-hmm. They do say that there was a culture of resentment that stemmed from that election, not defeat, but loss, I guess. Yeah, in a way, I've lost my train of thought, sorry.
COVID-19.
Yes, COVID-19, yeah. So They believed, National Party firmly believed, that it was going to be a one-term government, and all the signs were there from the beginning that that they weren't very together, that they were kind of out of practice in government, and National essentially knew where all the bodies were buried, so they were a very good, efficient opposition machine. And so, yeah, they believed, they thought that they could take Ardern's government down. Mm. As it happened, it was the absolute opposite. Mm. But maybe we would be in a totally different position if it wasn't for COVID-19, but, you know, that was, you know...
Such is life. You can't reverse it.
The election thanked the Ardern government for what they did.
Yes, what the thing I love about your reporting, whether it's in this book or generally, is that, like, all the little details, all the little, you know, the car that someone drives in, what they had for dinner, all the little nuances and conversations and relationships between politicians. And many of those central figures, it's interesting to reflect, are gone. The likes of Bill English, Amy Adams, Simon Bridges, Paula Bennett. But two remain in the National Caucus, Judith Collins and Todd Muller. What impact are they having now?
Yeah, this is a tough one because it's really hard to see what's in their future, you know? It's really, really difficult. And this was true of the previous Labour in opposition. A lot of those MPs stuck around because it's real tough to get a job when you're an opposition MP. No one wants you, basically. and so I guess, what now for Judith Collins? You know, she's actually, I don't know if you probably follow her on social media. She's actually doing a tremendous job in the portfolio, science portfolio she has. She's working really hard. She's out there all the time.
She always does. People say she's very effective in her portfolio.
She was a very effective minister. So she doesn't show any signs whatsoever of giving up. There's a lot of talk heading into the next election about who's going to step down. We're definitely going to see in the coming months a lot of resignations, I think, on both sides of the House. But I don't know. Judith always has the capacity to surprise, and I wouldn't rule her out. I think she might just stick with it. Todd Muller is harder to say. I mean, does he have a role in a future cabinet? That's a tough one. You know, he obviously demonstrated that he couldn't hack the pressure as leader. Would he be a good minister if National ascended to government next year? It'll be a really interesting thing for a future prime minister to think about. But, you know, he obviously had a great career in business. Does he have a future perhaps in mental health advocacy? Because he has talked really eloquently about the pressures that he faced. So, who knows? Wants to watch.
Last question then. Is the Civil War over?
Well, I always say, like, never predict anything in politics because you're generally from week to week.
Politics, economics,
I'm not a betting woman, but I think the truce is fragile, shall we say. Like, it all comes down to success. So far, the Willis-Luxon combination have been pretty successful. I mean, the latest poll notwithstanding. The trends are there. It feels like it's going to be a competitive election next year. If Luxon continues to flounder, as he has been a little bit, you know, in his public interviews and some of the foots wrong that he's done recently, I don't think that the tensions are far from the surface. And none of the tensions that dog the National Party have been resolved, whether that's the personal ambitions, whether it's the competition between the Liberal and Conservative, and generally just, I don't want to give too much about the ending of the book away, but there's a real tension between what does the National Party stand, what's the soul of the National Party versus are they going to continue to be the party of key, which I very much see as a party that exists only to exist in government, to hold power.
We'll let viewers find out that ending for themselves. Thank you so much for your time. Congratulations, Andrea. This is Andrea's book, Blue Blood, The Inside Story of the National Party in Crisis. Kua mutu, that is Q&A for this week. From the Q&A team, thanks for watching. And ngā mihi ki a koutou I ngā karere. Thanks for your feedback. Hei te rā, Wiki. We'll see you next Sunday at 9 a.m.